From axes to guns and every weapon in between, serial killers have made killing look like a twisted form of art. They've written their names in history with blood, some a bit deeper than others. Some had patterns and reasons for killing all these people, others did not. Murdering people in cold blood was a sport for some of these people, and some, no one could ever figure out why they committed these evil acts, no matter how deep the investigation went. The infamy of serial killers is widespread, and in this video, I'll share with you the most famous serial killers of all time who left me completely shocked. You'll be horrified at some of the crimes these individuals committed, and viewer discretion is advised. Now, let's get right into it. We start with Jack the Ripper. Jack the Ripper, a British serial killer and likely a cannibal, the Ripper was never caught or identified. His reign of rampage ran through London in the late 1800s and paved the way for other killers. You could say he was some sort of twisted pioneer. The Ripper operated around the Whitechapel district of London, and this earned him one of his other aliases, the Whitechapel Murderer. The interesting thing about this district is that it was London's red light district, and it was brimming with brothels, bars, and gang hideouts. With the London Metropolitan Police estimating that there were about 62 brothels and 1,200 prostitutes active at any time, it is quite safe to admit that Jack would have had his pick of potential victims. Between April 1888 and February 1891, a series of murders saw 11 prostitutes die tragic deaths. Investigators later said that not all of these murders were the work of the Ripper, as some did not fit his modus operandi. Mary Ann Nichols. That's the name of the first victim linked to Jack the Ripper, and she had become a prostitute after she separated from her husband, William Nichols. Mary's body was found at 3:40 a.m. on the 31st of August, 1888. The coroner reported that she died of a neck wound caused by a medium-length knife blade that was lethally sharp and was also used to disfigure her body. As expected, Whitechapel became a hub of fear. Everybody walked around with crippling fear, their eyes constantly peeking behind to be sure they weren't being followed. But just 2 days after Mary's burial, another body was found. Annie Chapman was also separated from her husband and had reportedly become a companion to strange men. The last person to see her alive, one Mrs. Long, claimed that she saw Annie talking to a strange man. She said that the man Annie was talking to was a little taller than she, was dark-haired with the build of a 40-year-old, and had a foreign and genteel appearance with a deerstalker hat. Mrs. Long remembered seeing Annie at that time because she heard the clock of a brewery located near the scene chime from striking the half hour. Annie also died of a neck wound caused by a knife, and because her face was so swollen and her tongue protruding, she was also asphyxiated. This clearly showed that the criminal had taken time with the body of this woman. As if that wasn't enough, Jack sent a 2-page letter after this incident to a news agency, ridiculing the authorities about their inability to apprehend him. 3 days after the Dear Boss letter, a double murder was discovered. The bodies of Liz Stride and Catherine Endowis were found within 45 minutes of each other. Both were prostitutes murdered in the same gruesome way and left to be discovered on the street. Although the double murder turned up some leads, the Ripper remained at large and was never identified. Several more letters outlined the killer's acts, and these drove police to assume him to be some sort of butcher or possibly a surgeon. It's honestly quite a shame that he never had to answer for his crimes. His identity remains a mystery until this day. Moving on, Ted Bundy. It's impossible for me to make a list of serial killers and leave out Theodore Robert Bundy, America's most charismatic killer and arguably the most famous. The campus killer is considered to have been attracted to young adolescents and also had a sick attraction to dead bodies. Add that with a degree in psychology and you have a ruthlessly capable murderer. Bundy's criminal nature first started to manifest through petty theft and shoplifting type offenses. This penchant for crime stayed with him and grew as his mental health deteriorated until it manifested into his first murder attempt. On the 4th of January, 1974, Bundy broke into the basement bedroom of another student at his college at the University of Washington. He hit her with a blunt object while she slept and sexually assaulted her. She came out of the attack with permanent brain damage. Ted succeeded in killing three other students before April, and his name was not tied to any of those murders. His girlfriend, Liz Klopfer, got very suspicious when Ted pushed her into a river without a word of warning and made absolutely no attempt to help her get out of the water. This was, of course, the end of their relationship. A few days later, Bundy disappeared after implying that he would meet up with Klopfer. Instead, it was later discovered that he went to Lake Sammamish, where he donned a fake cast and even a faker British accent, which he used to ask young women on holiday to assist him with some imaginary trouble he cooked up. Only two ladies, Janice Ott and Denise Nasland, followed him, one 4 hours after the other. Reports say that he forced one lady to watch as he raped and killed the other before he then killed her. When their skeletons were found, both Ott and Nasland were missing their heads. There were a number of witnesses to this crime, so the police released a rough sketch of the suspect. Ted's girlfriend, Liz, and his friend, Ann Rule, identified him as the suspect, but the police ignored their claim because of Bundy's reputation as a well-mannered student. He changed schools to continue with a law degree and would go on to kill four more women in his first semester. One of these women was a 13-year-old girl who he took to a hotel room, abused, and drowned in the bathtub. After Bundy's many arrests and escapes, he was finally charged after being connected to a double murder he committed at a sorority house. His trial was one of the most popular in American history, not just because it was televised, but also because he waived the right to legal counsel and represented himself while claiming not guilty. He would talk about his murders in the third person and in a purely hypothetical, sick way. He was convicted and sentenced to execution. His sentencing triggered more confessions. A memoir written after his death revealed that he had confessed to over 100 murders. Bundy's violent nature was later diagnosed to be a side effect of him being manic depressive. Reportedly, he committed these murders in a depressive state. Bundy was executed by the electric chair on the 24th of January, 1989. But his infamy lives on and was immortalized in the 2020 movie Incredibly Wicked, Shockingly Evil, and Vile. That was exactly the sentence the presiding judge used to describe Bundy's crime when he was finally declared guilty. Up next, John Wayne Gacy Jr. Gacy, like many other serial killers, had the perfect moral standing to get away with his crimes. In a way, you could even say his overconfidence was what led to his eventual downfall. Sufjan Stevens even wrote about the killer in a song with the same name. John Gacy was a serial rapist who seemed to enjoy assaulting young boys and then choking them to death. He wasn't always this way, though. Before the advent of Gacy's criminal days, he was a married man and father who was beloved by his community. He had a hard childhood with an abusive father and mother, but he escaped that life, and he worked odd jobs to keep himself going. One of these jobs, however, was at a funeral home where his boss had suspicions about his quote-unquote closeness with the dead bodies. When he left that job, he moved to Springfield, Illinois, where he met his first wife, and they married. Gacy got involved in activism and construction, and then started to rack up petty charges. He got divorced from his first wife after he was arrested for assaulting a young man while his wife was in labor. Gacy would then change towns and remarry. From there, his alter ego was born, Pogo the Clown. He used the character to support himself and showed up at charity events, fundraisers, and children's parties. When his murders came to light, this earned him the Killer Clown nickname. These murders began after he was given clearance by the US Secret Service, and his first victim was a young man named Tim McCoy. John Wayne Gacy was unique in a very dangerous way. He enjoyed being with little boys. His lust for juveniles drove him to assault and kill adolescent young men and hide their bodies. Young men seen around Gacy would often turn up missing, and his firm status as a lovable father figure in his community allowed him to stay off the radar of police. Imagine escaping, being called a murderer because you have somehow managed to make the entire town believe you're a lovable father figure. However it played out, his web started to unravel when a 15-year-old boy, Rob Priest, went missing. Rob was supposed to meet with his mother for her birthday party, but he asked her to wait while he went to see a man about a construction job. Rob never came back, and his family was pretty quick to alert the police. After an investigation, they discovered that Gacy's construction company had just finished up a job at the pharmacy where Priest was working. John Gacy was asked to report to the police station, and he sounded very agreeable, but he didn't show up until 3 a.m. the next morning. When he did, he was covered in mud and dirt. He was asked to go home, as the officer in charge of his case wasn't around, but soon after, he was served a search warrant for his house. The police found no concrete evidence to be able to pin Rob Priest's disappearance on Gacy. However, they found items belonging to many other missing boys. This made them put Gacy under surveillance. It was the surveillance team Gacy invited in for a cup of coffee who smelled something foul in the house. This led to another search, and body after body was discovered under John Gacy's floorboards. Gacy later cracked and told the authorities where the remaining bodies he had hidden were. All except for Rob Priest were found. It turned out that the night Gacy showed up covered in mud, he had gone to hide Priest's body around the lake, and it was never found again. Gacy was convicted of rape and 33 counts of murder and sentenced to death by lethal injection in 1994. He had earlier tried to feign insanity by blaming an imaginary alter ego, Jack, and then claimed innocence, insisting he was set up by his employees. It fell on deaf ears. Gacy was executed on the 10th of May, 1994, and his final words on this earth were, quote unquote, "Kiss my ass." Now, Jeffrey Dahmer. He said, "After the fear and terror of what I'd done had left, which took about a month or two, I started it all over again. From then on, it was a craving, a hunger. I don't know how to describe it, a compulsion, and I just kept doing it, and doing it, whenever the opportunity presented itself." Those were the words of the Milwaukee cannibal when he wanted to describe what killing and eating another human felt like. Dahmer one-upped all the previously mentioned killers on this list in a sick, sick way. He ate his victims. A confirmed cannibalistic serial killer. And there's more. He was also a necrophiliac, and he knew his way around different poisons. Jeffrey was an introverted child who spent a lot of time at an animal cemetery that he built, and he eventually grew into an alcoholic as a teenager. His drinking was so bad that he had to drop out of college because of it. His first murder victim was Stephen Hicks, who Jeffrey invited in for drinks. Stephen wanted to leave, and because Jeffrey did not want him to, he ended up bludgeoned to death and buried near the animal cemetery. Dahmer then joined the army, but was honorably discharged because of his drinking. He moved on to a hospital in Miami Beach, Florida, but he was again kicked out for excessive drinking. Dahmer was asked to move out of his grandmother's home because of the terrible smell emanating from the basement. Dahmer was bringing in dead animals to melt in various chemicals. His first two arrests were for indecent exposure. The second arrest was because he had masturbated in front of two young boys. That same year, he got in trouble for drugging and sexually fondling a 13-year-old boy. After spending time in prison, he moved to a new apartment in Milwaukee, the infamous apartment 213 of the Oxford Apartments complex. In the same year he was released, Koneric Synthasymphone, the younger brother of the boy he drugged earlier on, escaped from Dahmer's home and went to report that he was drugged and sexually abused. On the 22nd of July, another intended victim escaped, and this time, Dahmer didn't walk free. This last arrest led to the police uncovering items in his possession, such as four human skulls, several dismembered body parts, and strips of human flesh, neatly wrapped in the refrigerator. Add that to a barrel containing human torsos and blue vats containing whole human bodies was enough evidence to put Jeffrey away for good. He was sentenced for 15 murders and ended up being killed in prison while serving his 957-year sentence. Dahmer is a cautionary tale to always, always guard your drink while you're out. So next time you're out, be sure to be aware. It was a known fact that Jeffrey would visit gay bars to coax young men of color into coming to his house to drink with him or watch pornography. You just never know if the person next to you has a cynical, ulterior motive. Now, the last killer on this list is Pedro Lopez. Pedro Alonso Lopez is also known as the Monster of Andes. This serial killer, serial rapist, and abductor never held a job in his life. The man's level of psychopathy saw him hosting tea parties with the dead bodies of his victims and burying multiple bodies in shallow graves. The Colombian is believed to have murdered over 300 girls across Colombia, Ecuador, and Peru. The son of a prostitute, Lopez was kicked out of the house at 8 years old when he was caught molesting his sister. His luck ran out completely when he was lured by a pedophile with the promise of food. Instead, he was repeatedly sodomized. He escaped from there and joined a street gang where he lasted 4 years. He was taken in by an American family and started attending a school for orphans where he was later molested again by a teacher. Later, Lopez would be arrested and a few days into his sentence, he was gang raped by three other inmates. He hunted them all down, every single one, and killed them, one after another, gaining some respect for himself inside prison. After his release, he started abducting, raping, and killing an average of 3 girls per week. He was almost killed in Peru when he attempted to abduct a 9-year-old child from an Indian tribe. He was saved by a missionary, set free, and continued to go on a spree through Colombia and Ecuador, claiming many more victims. Lopez would rape and strangle young girls and dump their bodies in shallow graves. His Waterloo came in Ecuador when he was caught trying to abduct a girl and was apprehended by the police, who would convince him to show them some of the graves where his victims lay. When he was released from his Ecuadorian jail on good behavior, of all things, he was deported to Colombia. Through some reluctance on the part of the authorities, he never served a sentence in Colombia and was only cited a few times after that. But you know what's scariest? He is presumed to still be alive and at large. And there you have it, some of the most infamous serial killers in history. Do you know any others we missed? Let me know in the usual place. Thanks so much for watching. I really appreciate your support. If you enjoyed this video and want to be first in line for new videos, please subscribe to the channel so you never miss out. Also, please smash that like button and don't forget to share with your friends. It goes a long way to helping the channel grow and it doesn't cost you anything. I'll see you real soon in the next one. Thanks for watching.